14-9 game between UTD and Centenary. As we at Tiger Network have the privilege of being joined by Trinity Tigers pitcher Joseph Shavana, who started yesterday's game against UTD. Joe, how are you doing?
I'm doing pretty good. It's good to be here this afternoon. So it's nice to be at the field getting ready to watch another great game.
Yeah, it looks like your game's not going to be starting for quite some time based on this one. 14-9, high-scoring affair that is nowhere close to being done in the top of the sixth. But, Joe, you threw a great game yesterday going into the eighth inning, a full seven from you in a 1-0 victory. What went into that performance?
I think it was just the preparation throughout the week. I mean, I've had some things I've been working on, and the last 2 weeks I've been working to try and fix them. And yeah, yesterday was a little bit of, well, it was a big progression into it. I still have more to work on, so I'm excited to see where this thing goes if I keep doing what I'm supposed to do.
What did you notice the most in terms of your improvement, in terms of things you've been working on?
I'd say it's keeping the tempo slow. I mean, I feel like I usually get really into the game, even though it doesn't really show, but my internal clock starts to race. So just, keeping that slow and then just keeping the self-pressure out of it. I mean, I feel like external pressure isn't too bad, but most of the time it's all internal and just being able to deal with it and not doing that to myself.
2-2 pitch outside, ball four, and the leadoff man aboard for UTD. Joe, you faced these guys yesterday. What do you make of this lineup as a whole?
I thought they were, they're obviously good hitters. They're really aggressive early. I mean, they know what to look for, what not to. I mean, they didn't really swing at balls that they didn't see as strikes very often. Once you proved you can throw it for a strike, they started swinging. So, they're a really good team. It was fun throwing against them. Those are the guys you want to pitch against.
Throw to first. Not quite in time, though. It looked like it had a chance. The nine-hole hitter, Jaeger Self, up for UTD. Also important to mention a new pitcher in for Centenary to start this inning. It's Hank Bennett, the senior. Joe, you've been familiar with Centenary over the past few years in conference. What's it going to be like to play them not in conference?
I don't know. I feel like it's going to be pretty similar to a conference game. Both of us are going to come in wanting to beat each other. I mean, they drove from Louisiana all the way over here, so they're definitely going to be fired up to play us, and then we're, trying to win this series, quote-unquote, even though we're not playing the same team. But, I think, like I said, it's going to be the same atmosphere as a conference game. I think it'll be interesting to see how it plays out.
That's grounded foul. Runner will have to go back in Munoz. UTD, obviously a very potent offense. You and Will Hellings combined to shut them out. What did it feel like to get the shutout, knowing there wasn't much run support coming and you were just out there having to throw up zeros?
It was, during the game, I didn't really think about it too much. I was like, it's an 0-1 game. I didn't think I have to literally not give up a single run. And it wasn't till after I came out where I was like, oh, wow, we can't give up a single run. otherwise we tie, there's extra innings or we possibly lose. After the game, it was just awesome to think about that, with one run, we're very capable of winning a game against a really good team. I think it goes to show, how good the starters are and the relievers, the closers are on our pitching staff.
What's the feeling like knowing that this team can win 15-14 and also 1-0?
I think it shows that when our offense is struggling, our pitching, our defense is going to go out there and almost pick up the slack. And then, when our pitching is struggling, the offense is going to respond just as well and say, we got to put up runs if we want to win a game. So I think we complement each other very well, because obviously we're not going to be perfect every time. Neither is hitting. Hitting 3 out of 10 times, you're going to get on base, and that's a great hitter. So I think just pulling for each other is what's been really good for this team this year.
And Self grounds into the fielder's choice. He's safe at first. And that flips the lineup over for Rexon, who's 2-for-4 today. UT Dallas in a 14-9 ball game. Centenary trying to hold the lead, or hold the deficit, I should say. Trying to put themselves back in this thing. Joe, only 4 walks for you yesterday. We know that's been an issue in the past 2 starts. What do you make of your improvement in that category?
I think staying away from the windup is definitely something that helped later in the game. I realized, looking back at just about every walk I've had, it's all been from the windup. So clearly I need to work on the windup, but it's honestly way more fun when you pitch without walking so many hitters. It makes it way easier to pitch.
It also seemed like, this is something Luke observed, that when you walked somebody, it was with 2 outs and it didn't really hurt you. Was that something situationally that went into it?
I mean, there's good walks and bad walks. I mean, obviously, you know, no outs, you don't want to walk a guy. I mean, that's usually going to end up being a run. With 2 outs, it's like 3-2 count. You know, if I'm feeling good, which I was yesterday, I'm going to throw him something out of zone, try and take a strikeout. If not, if I get a walk, reset on the next guy. But yeah, it's definitely situational. It's just based on how the game is rolling and how you're feeling yourself as a pitcher. So I thought I felt pretty good.
Joe, I think you threw around 111 pitches yesterday. Is that the correct count?
Yeah, I heard 111 from somebody and 113, so somewhere in between.
How many more do you think you could have thrown?
You know, Dave asked me if I felt good, and I said I felt great. So I think I could have got more, but if I'm being honest, when I went out there that 8th inning, I was gone. Like, my arm, I don't think I reached a single ball to the plate in my warm-ups. I think it was also partially because of the long inning we had. I mean, we had, runners first and second. We had long ABs, so my arm just got cold. But I don't know. Be interested to see how many pitches I can throw in a game and still feel good. I'd say I'd hit the sweet spot yesterday, about where I want to be.
Well, a full 7 innings, that's a pretty good sweet spot.
I'll take it. I mean, it was a fun game yesterday.
Joe, you've talked to me before about your time in Wisconsin this summer, playing summer ball. Why don't you go over for the audience what that experience was like?
I mean, it was fun. Like, it was definitely, well, first of all, I was in a brand new state that I'd never been to, so seeing a different scenery was pretty cool. But you know, just the amount of games we played and the interaction with the fans is just one of those things where it's like, you know, you don't really get this anywhere else other than summer ball. I mean, you got kids, parents, like, coming up asking for signatures. You got them, like, really pulling behind you, the host parents, you know, again, like, just supporting you in everything you do, trying to get to know you, really treating you as one of their own. So, I mean, it was a great time. It was probably one of the best seasons I've had pitching. It's just nice feeding off of the other guys, meeting new people. Definitely enjoyed it.
So you stayed with the host family, is that correct?
I did. So I live 30 minutes away from the city, so we had to drive 30 minutes every day to the field and back, which honestly wasn't that bad once, like, you realize, like, you're gonna have to do it. If you play the right music, you're chilling.
It's now a 3-2 count, runner on second in the 14-9 game with 2 down in this inning. Here with Tigers pitcher Joseph Chavana. And foul tip into the glove. That's strike 3. As we'll head to the bottom of the 6th, 14-9. Centenary still in a hole. Welcome back to San Antonio. We're here on Tiger Network for the bottom of the sixth inning in a 14-9 game. Centenary trying to work their way back in this game. And we're here with another Trinity pitcher who threw yesterday. It's Will Hellings. Will, how are you?
I'm doing great. It's great to be here, Cole. Thanks for having me.
Will, obviously a great game yesterday. What was it like to come into a situation where it was 1-0 and you knew any mistake could really turn the game around?
It was exciting. I mean, just had butterflies warming up. It's just one of those moments where He does a good job of really, really being a personable guy. He loves us. He's funny. He hangs out with us all the time at practice and games and loves joking around. But when it's time to get serious, he does a good job of locking in. And he really takes winning seriously. So it's a great relationship to have with the coach, and I'm really thankful for it.
And the catch made in center field by Yeager's self. What's it like as a pitcher to have a defensive play like that behind you?
I love it. That stuff gets me fired up. When I see defense laying out and sacrificing their body for a play like that, it really just gets the blood flowing and makes me want to throw harder and strike the guys out and do my part.
And that brings up the catcher, Jake Gaunce. So the runner on second for Centenary. Hits that to right. Finn makes the catch, and there's two down in the inning.
Jake Gaunce is actually one of my former teammates.
Really? Where'd you play with him?
At Odessa College.
You know, I was actually wondering that. I saw that when I was prepping for this game. I forgot to do some investigation on it, but now we know.
Yeah, I've got a couple teammates. The starting pitcher for UTD was actually a teammate of mine as well, Tobin Oler. And so I've got a couple buddies that we play against throughout the year, and so it's kind of a cool thing when you come from a junior college when you all kind of spread out after your 2 years, so you get play against your friends and see how they're doing at other schools. So
runner goes, takes third base, so the 10th run for Centenary 90 feet away. What's it like to play against former teammates in terms of information? Do you feel like you know more about them?
Definitely, but I think they also know more about me, so it evens out, but it is definitely fun to face one of your teammates or pitch against them, because you know what to expect, but they kind of know what to expect too. So it brings a fun challenge.
I would assume, especially with Jake Gauntz being a catcher, if you were throwing that game, he could tell his teammates, hey, he likes to do this in this situation.
Yeah, definitely. He caught me many times, so I think he could definitely relay some information to them on me, which I don't like to think about that, but hopefully I can overcome that if it does come to that situation.
It's something to keep in mind for the last weekend of the regular season when the Tigers head to Shreveport. Game that could mean a lot in terms of conference standings. The runner still at third base, two down in the inning. Now in a 2-0 count. It's Kenny Garza, the senior from League City, Texas, still working in this inning, trying to maintain the UT Dallas lead. Strike called. Is it weird to have the series broken up, because you play Centenary today, you play UT Dallas on either end of that? Is that odd, or is it just business as usual?
I think a little bit of both. I think we looked at the schedule and we saw five games this week kind of spread out, and playing Thursday through Sunday is obviously a challenge, but I think we have the mindset of just business as usual. Like we come into each game ready to win, ready to give our all to the game, and so I think we
top of the seventh in San Antonio. Hank Bennett back out there for his second inning of work, going against Luke Finn, sitting 328 on the year. 25 runs scored. Centenary able to get a run back in that last half inning. Still a lot of work to do. So I'm joined back by Luke Terry. Luke, always good to get the perspective one of the Tigers pitchers who threw yesterday.
Yeah, good to hear what they had to say about their performances last night. Very, very impressive job, as Trinity needed just those two arms to go the distance against what Joseph Chavanna said was a very, very impressive UT Dallas offense. But those guys combined and held them to zero runs on five hits yesterday. Very, very impressive day.
As that pitch misses, Luke Finn ahead in a hitter's count, 3-1. But that's been the combination for the Tigers on Friday nights. Chavanna will throw the first six and change usually. Went 5 2/3 one time. That's his shortest outing of the season. Full seven last night. And then Will Hellings will come in to shut the door with whatever score it is. Whether it's 1-0 or coming in against Babson in an 8-2 game. It's now a full count pitch. Swung on and fouled off. But fortunately, if you're centenary, that is not a combination that you're going to have to worry about. Both of those guys throwing yesterday. Hit in the air to right, and it falls as Finn is aboard with a leadoff knock. So Finn erasing that 0-for-0 stat line. He was aboard with a walk and a hit by pitch. Also had a sack fly and a sack bunt. Now is a single.
Yeah, and just a huge offensive output for each of these squads today. Now 13 hits on the afternoon for each of these teams. That last one, the Comets able to draw even with Centenary, who to that point in the game had been outscoring them.
It's now an 0-1 count to Bivens, the third baseman who's made some nice plays defensively. So he hits that in the air to right, and the catch is made by Benoit for out number one.
Really, it's this Comets offense that's capitalized on some other statistical categories here today. Not a ton of walks, just five so far, which certainly outpaces the Gents, but they've, in addition to that, reached via the hit by pitch three times. They've gotten aboard because of errors an additional few times. They're just taking free passes any way that they can get them. And in addition to that, 13 hits is nothing to shy away from. Very impressive in the batter's box using the bat as well, but it's certainly been supplemented en route to these 14 runs.
Swing and a miss as the throw back to first, not in time. That almost looked like a pitch out. But gets the swing and miss from Landry. Landry 2-for-4 today. He's singled his last two times up. He's also reached on a fielder's choice, now working with Finn on first, one down in the inning.
And it was a little awkward right there, as you're right. It was a pitch delivered almost in that opposite batter's box, and Landry swung through it. After the fact, he kind of checked down to his third base coach and was pointing to his teammate in Finn over at first, mouthing kind of as if to say, you know, what's he doing down there? Not sure if there was supposed to be a hit and run or something of the sort on.
And that one was a pitch out, but Finn back barely in time.
Yeah, and they've tried that a couple of times now in this at bat. Finn back safely at each of those opportunities, but you're right, very narrowly sneaking the hand in there under the tag.
I'll check on him again. Very concerned with Luke Finn right now. Finn, not a huge threat to steal as of now, though he does have six stolen bases on the year. Has yet to be caught, and it looked like he was on the run there.
and had to assume that it was going to come at some point in this at bat with as much attention has been paid to him by Hank Bennett.
And more attention given.
Still perhaps a little bit of a surprise in a five-run ball game paying that much attention to someone over there on first base.
And more given. So this may be the longest at-bat in the game, just in terms of time in the batter's box.
Yeah, I would agree with you there.
Runner goes. Throw to second, not in time, so all the attention and none of the reward as Luke Finn has his seventh stolen base of the year.
And ultimately, just too many opportunities for Finn to gauge that move, that pickoff back to first, whether it was the back pick or whether it was Bennett throwing over to check in on him and figured out exactly how much of a lead he could grab.
Finn goes again, grounder to third. Finn thought about coming home, has to dive back to third base. He's safe. And because of that, the runner is safe at first. Runners at the corners, only one down because of Luke Finn's base running.
Yeah, and realistically in this situation, Menard coming up with a baseball over there at third, I think has to recognize that while Finn is running pretty aggressively and rounding third base right there, it's pretty unlikely that he actually goes home, especially with that original check. He looks over just once, and I'm not sure committing to trying to dive and tag that lead runner out is the best approach.
Now the DH, Coulthard up. Landry able to reach. I wouldn't even know how to score that. A weird sequence of events. Good job by Gantz to keep that pitch in front of him. It's 2-0.
Yeah, I'm not sure you can hand out an error right there, but I believe would be a fielder's choice that goes to Menard. Just doesn't result in an actual putout right there.
Coulthard 0-for-4 today. Has struck out twice. Puts that into right. And the catch is made, two down. Finn tagging. The throw not in time, and it's 15-9 UT Dallas.
And that's the threat of things right there. Had Centenary just elected to take that out at first base, they would have had two gone in the inning. At worst, if Finn does come around and show that aggressive base running trying to score, I think you have a very, very decent shot if you're Miller over there at third to throw him out at home. Instead, just one out in the inning, it allows for that sac fly opportunity, and the Comets, who have very, very effectively delivered in these types of situational hitting opportunities, do so again.
Breaking ball in for strike one to Peyton Taylor. Taylor, who has doubled and singled today. 2-for-3 on the day. As that's hit sharply but foul on the top of the batting cage. And not anymore.
Very briefly, just did not slow down for you there, Cole.
Taylor now in an 0-2 hole, outside 1-2. UT Dallas adding on to their lead in this inning, 15-9 now. Making things more difficult for Centenary, though, as Will Hellings wisely said, this game likely far from over. Skied to center. And the catch is made to end the inning. 15-9, UT Dallas has the lead as we head to the bottom of the seventh on Tiger Network. Hey. bottom of the seventh in San Antonio. 15-9, UT Dallas. And his first pitch swung on and fouled off. A new pitcher in for the Comets. It's Derek Bryden, the junior from Conroe, Texas, making his third appearance. But I have the pleasure of being joined by one of our SIDs, Peyton. Peyton, how are you doing?
I'm doing great, Cole. How are you?
Doing good. 15-9, so you know. But other than that, always good to be around baseball.
Oh, yeah. It's a heck of a day at the ballpark today.
Now, Peyton, you're an SID. You want to talk about, like, what that's like and then what you guys do?
Yeah, so I'm the assistant AD for multimedia here at Trinity. So I take care of all of our in-game photography, videography, and then social media content creation. So that's been a blast, as this one is skied out in center field and tracked down and caught by the Comets. And that'll retire the first of the inning.
Yeah, that's pretty good, man.
Thank you. Good stuff. I've done a couple soccer games in my career, so.
Oh, really?
I've been on the broadcast a few times.
Yes. One down in the bottom of the seventh. So, Peyton, I heard that you're getting Jimmy John's for everybody.
I am. I am the pickup man when it comes to our lunch food today. So we had to call in the man, Jimmy, as this one is called strike.
The zone's been a little weird. That one seemed fine, but in general, that outside part of the plate seems like it's been open as Clay Menard up.
Yeah. I've been back and forth between the softball game here at Trinity and this baseball game, so I haven't been able to catch the zones very well at either one, but I take your word for it.
2-1 count, one down in the bottom of the seventh. Leadoff man for Centenary. Hits that to shallow center. And the catch made by Self for out number two. Yeah, we have softball going on today. What was the score that you last checked?
Oh, we got the 8-0 Mercy in the first game. So we'll see what happens in the second as the Tigers are taking on Shriner. In the first doubleheader conference play this weekend.
Pitch just high for ball one to Colin Pitts, who's 1-for-2 today, hitting over 400 on the year. What's it like being in your job when there's a bunch of sports happening at once? I know today it's only two different ones, but in the past we've had basketball, softball, tennis, and baseball all on the same day.
Oh, last weekend I about wore a hole in my shoe running around so much. So that was a good time with the track meet and baseball and the basketball regionals all going on as this one's fouled off. But, yeah, it's a bunch of fun. You know, just I tell everybody working in sports is a dream because you're doing something that other people wish they could do. So I get, you know, get paid to go watch baseball games basically. So can't complain with that.
No, that's a really good point. So that's high to make it 2-2. UTD and Centenary meeting for the second time in 2 days. UTD taking the first matchup in this weekend series.
It is an interesting matchup seeing both these teams drive all the way down to San Antonio for a game they didn't have to drive more than a couple hours for back home.
That'll end the inning. Strike three. Still 15-9 as Centenary can't climb any further back. bottom of the seventh on Tiger Network, 15-9. UTD leads Centenary as Efren Munoz up to bat. I have the privilege of being joined by another Tigers pitcher, Josh Witte. And Josh, we talk about all the events happening on the campus of Trinity University, most notably softball today. But in the area, you played a very important golf match.
Yeah, I mean, it was a tough, hard-fought match. It was me and Cam Champness, shortstop for the Trinity Tigers, and versus Luke Pfeiffer and Jack Breezy, both pitchers. And, you know, it came down to the wire. We shot two under. They shot one under. It was a hell of a golf game.
What was the pressure like in that moment coming down to the 18th hole?
It was tough. I'll tell you, it was a one shot game going into it. You know, we both hit good drives on the hole. Came down to the approach shot, and you know, we came through. What more can I say?
How much did the pressure of knowing the winner gets to be interviewed on the broadcast?
You know, pressure is difficult, but you know, with a reward like this, I really just brought my all, and you know, it's a little unfortunate we can't have Cam join us on the broadcast, but you know, I know the dugout right now or in the batting cages, he's cheering me on.
Did somebody carry, or was it a team effort combined with the both of you?
You know, on their team, I will say Jack Breezy put in a lot of the work, but you know, Luke played pretty well too, but you know, on our team, it was pretty even. You know, we both had good rounds, and that's what we needed.
The diving play not able to be made by Landry in center field. UT Dallas has a runner aboard with one out. Blunt popped in the air by Rex, and that'll be an easy out. Quickly two down in the top of the eighth. Josh, have you ever been in this room before? See how we do this broadcast?
I have not. You know, I've always been interested in announcing myself. I've been, you know, about as big of a baseball fan as you can be for my entire life, and you know, it's pretty cool to see the other side of it.
Who's your team?
I'm an Astros fan. I'm born and raised in Houston, Texas, and you know, always been an Astros fan.
What do you make of them this year?
You know, I think they still got a good chance. You know, I think go to the eighth consecutive AL championship series, and you know, hopefully another ring.
As that's ripped down the line in right field. And they'll put runners at second and third for UTD, already up 15-9 in this one. So for those watching that don't know, Josh is a reliever. So what's it like to come in to high-pressure situations with guys on?
You know, it's difficult, but it's baseball. You know, it's something I've been doing for as long as I can remember. You know, I threw in relief a couple times at Grinnell. And I was playing there my freshman and sophomore year. And, I mean, it's really just a routine thing, you know, getting and finding what you need to do to be ready.
The catch is made, and that'll end this half of the inning. Josh, it's great to have you on. Congratulations.
Yeah, absolutely.
On
Thanks for
Breezy.
Having me.
As we'll head to the bottom of the eighth on Tiger Network. 3 hours and 8 minutes into this one. We're in the bottom of the eighth, a 15-9 game. That pitch misses for ball one. Derek Bryden still in the game for UT Dallas in his third appearance. Now that's high for ball two. Carson Livesay in the batter's box for Centenary. Swing and miss, strike one. The Gents trying to make a comeback. They don't have much time to do it.
No, down to their final six outs here in San Antonio. And really, with the way that this game has changed, especially in the back half of it, runs a little bit harder to come by. Imagine a six-run deficit at this point. Likely going to be a little bit too much to overcome. But things certainly going to have to start here with a leadoff hitter.
And ball four, as the leadoff hitter does reach. And it'll bring up Alex Miller with an opportunity to put Centenary back in the game.
Mentioned it just a couple of innings ago. This is a Centenary team that has done a very nice job today. For a little while there, they had 13 hits that actually led the way between these two squads as Miller fouls that one back behind home plate. It'll get out of play. But realistically, the thing that UTD has been able to use and separate themselves is finding other ways to get on base. They had more walks, more hit by pitches. Unfortunately for Centenary in the field defensively, they had just committed more errors.
Runner goes, throw not made. And Livesay takes second base.
So a welcome start here to the bottom of the eighth, finding a different way to get on base as Livesay was able to walk, now advancing over into scoring position.
Runner in scoring position for the first year, Alex Miller now. 0-2 count. Takes a ball high. Not a very competitive pitch.
And you talk about wanting to change the eye level, especially when you get ahead in counts. Usually it's with that fastball. You want a guy to start his hands on something up in the zone, something that he's realistically not going to be able to catch up to. So often, though, we see pitches wasted and truly not be very competitive because they come in at eye level, right? Changing eye level doesn't mean put it right across the guy's face. I think more often than not, you want it right across the chest, just about where you can see the lettering on these Centenary uniforms.
So Miller battles back even, now 2-2, and that gets him on the elbow, painfully so. It actually looks like he's limping. It might have gotten him on the leg. Either way, he takes first base, and there's two aboard with nobody out in the inning.
Yeah, that one, a breaking ball that misses arm side for Bryden right there. And Miller, who tried to mimic many of his teammates and getting down the line very quickly after being hit by that pitch, I think ultimately it either clipped his knee or that front foot or ankle area.
So Miller aboard, the teeth of this Centenary lineup, finding a way to get on base. And Benoit, who's 4-for-4, an RBI opportunity. He takes ball one.
Benoit, probably the bright spot for this Centenary squad the last 2 days. They've played very good baseball. They've put up a large number of runs, now up to 16 in their last two games, and continuing to threaten here in the bottom of the eighth.
Shoemake coming out of the dugout to talk to the umpire. That was earlier on your screen. Obviously not too thrilled with that call. So now runners at the corners with one down for Joby Boone. Boone 1-for-4 today. His one hit a single. He's flown out to center the other three times. But nonetheless, an opportunity for Centenary. Trying to at least put some pressure on UT Dallas in the top of the ninth. And they say he went around, 1-1. Breaking ball in the zone, 1-2.
Yeah, a really nice pitch from Bryden right there, dropping that in. A little bit of a front door breaking ball is Boone likely thinking that's going to finish inside on his hands, but late break brings that just back into the zone.
Did he go? Yes. As Boone strikes out, that's the second out of the inning. Close play, but that bat broke the plane.
And Derek Bryden right there walking away with a little bit of a sword. A very nice pitch. Back-to-back breaking balls on the inside part of the plate. Boone maybe recognizing the spin on it second consecutive time, seeing it in on his hands, forced him to start them. But that one just dropping out of the zone, just wipeout movement on it, and he didn't stand a chance.
It's now the catcher Gantz up for Centenary. 1-for-3 today. Flew out the last time he was up. He's also singled and been hit by a pitch. Takes it just high. Hit up the middle for a base knock. Livesay scores from third, and Centenary has 10 on the board.
And D3 baseball continues here in San Antonio, not very frequently. You can say a team scratches their 10th of the afternoon and still will find themselves behind, but that's exactly the case as the bats remain quite hot in San Antonio. It's been very, very difficult for either of these squads to induce swing and misses. There's only been 9 strikeouts here in this one.
That's grounded to first. And the short out to end the inning, but Centenary tacks on one more. It's 15-10. Thank you. Top of the ninth, Centenary trying to hold this deficit against UT Dallas, hoping for a ninth inning rally. As the leadoff man is Bivens for UT Dallas. Still facing Hank Bennett. Fouls that back to make it 0-2. Bennett in his first appearance of the season, he pitched two innings last year. But it's been a while. And he's put the cap on this UT Dallas offense, giving his team at least a chance. And announcer's jinx at work, a base hit for Bivens.
He's done very well, as you mentioned, Cole, despite the announcer's jinx right there. I think one of the most impressive things is the fact that this Centenary pitching staff has, in these last 2 days, still had to deal with these very dangerous bats of UT Dallas, even in games that at times have felt quite out of hand. Clearly, Centenary made it a contest late in yesterday's game one. But there were a lot of innings played where the Comets had a very large lead. Same case here this afternoon. And it's been the same bats out there the entire time. Bivens, who hit that grand slam yesterday, remains out there even late here in the top of the ninth in what is still a five-run ball game, and an affair where UT Dallas has scored 15. And this starting lineup has certainly had their opportunity and their chance at the plate. No new names being brought in to pinch hit.
These have been the guys for UTD in the 3 games they've played this weekend. Only one substitution is Nico Fernandez not catching in today's game. But it's been those 9 throughout. And everybody but Nico Fernandez, a transfer student at some point. Swing and a miss, strike 2. UT Dallas resorting to transfer students quite a bit. Got to talk to Coach Shoemake about that. He said the transfers are huge. They're heavy transfer school. He made the note that his entire infield and his entire outfield made of transfer students at some point. 26 of the 21 rostered players for UTD transfer students.
Yeah, pretty incredible proportion of this squad finding a new home during their collegiate career. It's an interesting dynamic, especially when you consider the fact that this is a UTD school that is going to be moving and transitioning from the D3 level to Division II. This will be their last year in Division III. So I have to wonder how that comes into play with so many guys that have relocated to play at the Division III level. See if they'll have the capacity and capabilities to continue next year, even once UT Dallas moves up in the level of competition.
Hit to deep right field, and it hits the wall. That'll be at least a double. Runner stops at third and puts 2 in scoring position with nobody out for UTD.
And we've talked about the wind here this weekend. It's changed direction. This time, perhaps keeping it in the yard in San Antonio. This one hit a very long way and just about halfway up the wall out there in right field. Landry got a lot of that baseball.
Good job by Benoit to recover and throw, holding Bivens at third, but a chance for Grayson Coulthard. As Coulthard thinks about that, fouls it off for strike 1.
Goldtharp giving the home plate umpire a long stare down right there, shaking his head after the fact. I think his argument would be that he didn't make any contact on that one. Would buy that he might have gone around.
Yeah, it didn't look like it live that he touched that ball, but that's the call that's made. Ball inside there, and it's 1-1. An RBI opportunity for the designated hitter to extend this lead and make it a football score. Ripped to first. They take the out at first base, and that holds the runners.
And Coulthard showing a little bit of frustration right there as he's going to turn and head back to his dugout. And with that, likely capping what's going to end as an 0-for-5 day. It's going to be the only Comet in this order that will not finish this game with a hit.
It's now Peyton Taylor up to the plate. Take strike one. Taylor 2-for-4 today. The double and the single has also reached a way of a hit by pitch. Outside 1-1. One down in the inning. Bivens on third. And the first baseman Landry waits on second.
Just gaudy numbers for this UTD offense today. 17 of 39 for a team batting average of 436. They've walked another five times. They have four extra base hits. They've been pretty electric with runners on and runners in scoring position. Runners in scoring position today, 9 of 18. Perfect, not perfect, but really, really admirable 500.
Hit in the air to left, and the catch made by Livesay. Throws to second. They don't get him there. Throw home, not in time. And aware base running from the Comets strikes again. They tack on another one. It's 16-10.
Yeah, and this one very hard hit off the bat. Good launch angle as this one hangs down, and it was Landry out there at second base who was caught in the middle of the base paths, but you're right. Bivens recognizing that this throw going back into second base, he was likely holding no matter what. It looked like on our first angle of this replay that he was going to hang up there at third base, but then recognizing where the throw was going made it a pretty easy job to move on home.
It'll bring up the eighth hitter, Munoz. Munoz 2-for-4 today, hitting 225 on the year. Also an update from the Trinity softball field. Trinity Tigers taking a 4-0 lead in their second game against Shriner University, first weekend of conference play for the Tigers. Won 8-0 in game one, opening up a 9-5 record. So a good start for Trinity softball, as that's high to make it 1-2. Of course, Centenary in the same conference as Trinity University softball. Grounded to short, and that'll end the inning. So 16-10 is the score for UT Dallas. Centenary, one more chance to tie this game. We'll come back for the bottom of the ninth on Tiger Network. Innings comes out for UTD and fires strike one against a pinch hitter for Centenary, Charlie Leek. Fouled off. 0-2. It's actually Andrew Landry up, the nine-hole hitter, as he's been for the entirety of today, the center fielder. Fouls that off to stay alive. Jake Jennings pitched in last night's game against the Trinity Tigers. So I'm assuming a lot of relievers are going to have to do double duty based on the doubleheader. Four games in 3 days for UT Dallas. Skied to center, the catch made by Self. And there's one away in the ninth.
And Jennings in that game against Trinity, a part of a 1-0 shutout win by the Tigers. The only run that Trinity was able to scratch in that one coming off Vera, who started that game and had a very impressive outing in his own right. But Jennings on the mound currently continuing to show the same stuff that he had yesterday. Good job in that first at-bat here in the bottom of the ninth, jumping ahead and taking advantage of it, forcing the hitter to go after something, breaking ball with this nice movement, finishing down in the zone that just couldn't be barreled up.
And as the order flips over for the Gents, Menard up. Is 1-for-4 today. Pitch way outside, and it's 2-1. Make it 3-1. So not what you want, up 6 runs.
But still, realistically, no harm done. I think Jennings is trying to be cute right here. Has just lost a couple of pitches arm side. It's a nice job of responding with a strike right there. And with a 6-run lead, you can afford to just get a get-me-over pitch. Not worried about Menard punishing anything, even if he was to leave the yard, which is still very unlikely. It would only be a 5-run ball game for at that point.
As that's fouled off to keep it at 3-2. Ball 4, and he loses Menard, who heads to first base with one out.
And it seemed like a consistent issue in that at-bat. Jennings just losing pitches arm side repeatedly, and unfortunately for him, he does so with that final offering and a full count and issues a walk here in the bottom of the ninth.
Because it'll bring up Colin Pitts. Drives that one to right. Back at the wall, it's gone. A home run for Colin Pitts. Puts 2 on the board for Centenary. It's 16-12.
And maybe a pseudo-announcer's jinx right there, right after I said Menard was not very likely to leave the yard and that Jennings could just continue to pound the strike zone. Colin Pitts steps up into the batter's box and sends one out over the wall in right field. He's going to don the maroon blazer as he heads back to Centenary's dugout. This one barely sneaking over the wall out there in right field. But despite that, UT Dallas preserving a 4-run lead. Still just 2 outs left to get.
First pitch strike to Carson Livesay. And now 1-1. First home run of the season for Colin Pitts. 2-run bomb, making this a 4-run game. So that's fouled back. And as you see the wind, those flags blowing the dead center, so maybe your announcer's jinx was forcing that wind to guide some of these baseballs out.
I don't know if I've seen an announcer's jinx that was fulfilled by divine intervention, but it kind of feels like it right there. Those flags blowing out to center right field, and I think you're right. Certainly got into the jet stream and carried out of here because of that.
Foul tip, strike 3. Centenary down to their last out, and it'll be Alex Miller. 1-for-4 today, was hit by a pitch the last time he was up. grounded down the line. And that's the ball game. UT Dallas wins once again against Centenary, this time 16-12, as they take two of their first three here in San Antonio. UT Dallas will next play the Trinity Tigers tomorrow with a 1 p.m. first pitch, and then they'll be back to Richardson. Centenary, on the other hand, more work to do today. They'll play the Trinity Tigers. A game that was supposed to start at 3 p.m., unlikely to be the case. We'll make sure to see what time that game will start, and we will be here for it. For everybody working today on this Saturday afternoon, alongside my partner Luke Terry, I'm Cole Isaacson, saying so long from San Antonio. Be sure to be back for Centenary and Trinity.